to two lovely little pups.
Ah, what a way to lose a race.
Who said anything about losing it?
Huh?
Up she gets, chases after the rest of the feed, passes them out one by one, and rubs home in easy winner.
And what about the two pups?
They came in second and top. Good to see you again, Dickie boy. God bless you. Dickie, pass out the points quick before I pass out myself with the toss.
I tell you, boy, you're getting too fond of the drink.
Yeah, well, just like this, chap. After I kicks the bucket,
yeah,
I'm going to give me body to science. So in the meantime, it is me duty to keep it well preserved in alcohol.
Why, whatever about the drink, boy? The fads will be the death of you. And what's more, the smoke have us all nearly sophisticated.
But you look who's talking. But you look who's talking, Dickie. He's like a fellow with one foot in the grave.
One foot in the grave.
Ladies and gentlemen, the Opera House proudly celebrates its 30th year, and you're welcome to this anniversary edition of Summer Revels. Thank you.
was going to say. Listen, I've only managed out to see it if I was packed at all. If you have any troubles though, have any problems, lift. This is going to tell me no, you're a common crow tonight. If you have any troubles or problems, let them at the door and collect them on the wheels. Let's be a crow, you know what I mean? That's what we are. Because God knows, there's an apprentice as I say, and I miss Gene. I miss the old church, I miss the bit of scare, and I miss the old crack, that's what I miss most of all. Anyway, I hope you're all the best of Father Maggie. Well, I'm not. What a dear I'm heir to putting down. You know now yourself, the one them days when everything seems to go against you. You've no luck with nothing like. I was so unlucky today that if I peeled the banana, there'd be nothing inside this. But I should have known. I said, wasn't it all of me horoscope in the echo last night? You see, I did piss skis myself. We had a common clothes. Very common. You see, I did piss skis myself. Although God knows, just my husband Peggy, he should be the piss skis. Because most of the time he's half that way. Anyway, the unfastened the echo. The very last one down as usual. Under Jimmy. And here's what I said. There'll be a case of mistaken identity. Be prepared for a shock. You'll have an interrupted journey. And a tall stranger. We'll have it no out for you, and you'll have it fit. And as far as God is be judged, didn't I come true? Listen now, and I tell you, you see, I went to the Residents Association social tonight. So I had to get a bit of shopping done this morning. So I was down to Dunstores, and the first thing I got was a head of cauliflower. To make a few sandwiches. You have lovely mouthful sandwiches. And I was pushing the cauliflower up in the trolley. When who comes up to me only get nosy old Jade. She's living second next door from us. I sure yeah knows her. She had them glasses like the end of Coca-Cola bottles. And she takes a gawk into the trolley. And she says, do you know, Madge? He's the image of his father. How could I see it? Sure, she wasn't fair out. But the other twice, you see, the case of mistaken in identity. So anyway, I went over and I got another few odds and ends. And next I went over to get a bit of liver to go over to cauliflower and the sandwiches. Did you mention it? And you know how much they wanted for a bit of liver? $2.60. $2.60 for a bit of liver? Listen, says I to the men, just for a meal I answered, not a transplant. I tell you know, we're in for a great night because it'll be a whole crowd, God bless you. And thanks very much though for making our job so easy, so we will have a good old night. This last night's now where I love. Anyway, when I was standing in the queue for the checkout, didn't the prices go up twice? And when the one handed me the bill for the few groceries I had, did I get a shock? But the other time, you see, the horoscope was right again. Anyway, I was waiting ages for the bus home, and halfway up Spangle Hill, didn't it break down? Of course, the interrupted journey. And the driver says, Elan, I have to get out here now, sissy, and wait for the next bus. Excuse me, I says, nice and polite, darling. Excuse me, I says,
Is it all right if I pick a few flowers while I'm waiting? I don't care what you do, sissy, real sassy. But he does more flowers around here. That's all right, my sissy. I have a packet of seeds with me. Anyway, wait, keep that for after. Anyway, when I was in, who was standing next to me but a tall man? And when eventually the next bus came along, so says I, with my look now, says I, sir, that bus will be full. Well, he didn't say a word. When he put his hand up and took out his glass eye and shut it up in the air that way. Did he make that, so says I, what are you doing that for? I'm just checking, says he, to see if there's any room upstairs. Straight away, a tall stranger will have an eye out for you. It's nice to hear that name, would you? But I can't stand, I can't stay tall. You know, too long, because I must go and get me hair done. And then I'm going to go up to try on a new blouse. I got marks and sparks. Here is the huge demand and extension. Of course, tis a very posh store, you know. Very posh. Tis so posh that even the shoplifters, they can get their stuff delivered. But I'm only hoping that the blouse will fit me. But of course it will. Did me horoscope say I'd have a fish? God bless you. Thanks very much.
Thank you.
he's in nearly set fire to me.
Oh, you're a good boy, Nazi, Nazi, Wally, Wally.
I do hope you haven't any more at home like him.
I have 7 others, God bless them.
You mean 8 altogether?
No, one after the other. And I have more with the weenies body off the crab.
Whenever I need a fish.
You must come every day, sir. No. But you know, your place is very familiar. You're massive. You're not from the corporation. That's it.
Certainly not. I'm Mrs. Matthews from Roach's Town.
You're not one of the matches to let the people in Academy Street.
No, I'm not.
Don't tell me you're one of the matches that owns the match of heart.
I'd have you know that all my people were wealthy landowners from Effin in County Limerick.
For the Effin matches. One of them, lad, he's very cute. He thought I wanted the matches. My matches at all while he did belong to the girl over there. Now that's a good boy, give him back that. Now isn't he a good boy? Where's my big dum-dum for my good body? There's a good boy. You know, he's very clever, you know. He can even walk the video machine. I went with the dad. He likes you. He wants you to suck his dummy. One day to suck his
dummy. Take it away, don't be disgusting.
Just my dog. You're fabulous. You mind your money, she's a dummy or thing.
And in case, Trevor couldn't fit me in for a wash and a boot bank. Behind
Maggie Murphy! I know that guy's anyway.
Bring a whole of them to yourself!
Maggie, you said your behind. She was dying in a bit of a stinger.
How dare you! You two common people! How dare you!
You're a goddess, you court hanger. Ready?
Yeah.
Hold on a sec. And I'll be over to you, Gavin.
Right, Gavin.
Well, little Gavin, did you come here to fit me? You see, I want to go to the social tonight, and I have to look me best.
Yeah, well, after those two ladies, that's it won't be long.
Thanks, Gavin, first, Gavin. And I knew you wouldn't let me down because I...
What?
Oh, little Wally, kitty, yeah! Oh, the big.
Maggie, he said hello to you. God knows I'll have him talking soon.
You see, go and rush it. As I am, you see, we spent 2 years of our lives getting them to walk and to talk. And the rest of our lives, get them to sit down and shut up. Is he Keaton, yes?
He is, God helps. And I tried the banjo, you know, but it did him no good. Even though he swallowed the whole tube of it. So now I heard rubs his gums with a drop of brandy. And he looked up it. But he's not me.
No.
He knows what I'm talking about. The mention of the brandy, and it drives him wild.
He's taking after his own for it. Emily, he's very cousin. He's like a little old man. Haven't you, Maggie? Why don't you give Miss back in?
You know, Maggie, I'm with you. I'm a big bop. think that's the right temperature?
Just perfect up.
Matches with exercise.
No, thank you.
You're so bad. In the top of Wally's back, 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 back. There you are. No. There you are, nobody. I won't keep you that much.
Yes, yes, yes. Fair the matter with me, Trilby, Jay.
It doesn't mind, miss. Excuse me. What's fair the matter, one of the effing matches?
Certainly not.
Why do you drink off your pop and give big ball and your dad?
Yeah, forgive me now for being so far, but I think I know as your fears. Were you walking up and getting in at his one time?
Certainly not.
But tell me, did he have matches? Is it an Irish tree in the car?
I'd have you know that I can trace my ancestors back to the kings of Tarlock.
Here we go, Fiona. You'll be going back to the year of the flood next. And tell us you were on the ark with Noah.
No, we were not on the ark with Noah. We had our own boat.
I seen you coming off a board down the keys. Excuse me, Mickey Gabriel. Will I have to wait much longer?
Now look here, you two. I was here first, and I may take some time.
Well, with a face like yours, that wouldn't surprise me one bit.
I'm at you, girl. We have to do something then and try and get rid of her.
Maggie, it just dawned on me.
Yeah.
It's always since I changed Wally's nappy. No wonder he's peevish.
I'm going to do it now, and here, come on, and I'll give you a hand. I'm sure Mrs. Betts is worth mine, even if it's just a little bag.
Now, Wally, I'm going to give you a lovely clean nappy, little
girl. Like the dusty old man, I say.
Maggie, look, no wonder, he was drenched.
Even after rash.
You know that? Oh yes, I have Bancello there. I mean, I have Johnson and a squeegee.
Yes.
Maggie.
Yeah.
Not close to time.
No, man. You're not doing it, Papa. I sure you hope to do it.
I was never so insulted in all my life. I'm leaving this establishment, and I'm never coming back here again.
you'll be a terrible last. Better bring in debt, won't you, Mother? I see she ain't taken up before your father sees it.
Come on, please. Who is next for the artist's creation?
I am it, Betty.
Would you mind if I went for my wash before you get me?
Do not talk, Dad.
Trevor. Chisoy.
Let me have a look at you. Let me have a look at you. Yes, I accept the challenge.
Come
this way. Thanks, Gretchen.
Thank you so much for this day. 10,000,
Mr. Trevor.
Well,
what
do you think?
Oh,
I think that tree
will
be flushed with
the lights. Anyway, I think it's too normal, like, you know.
Name of God, what's that? Excuse me, Geronimo.
Mrs. Horrigan, this one, eh, me? Crying on a hussy.
Oh, you are the hussy. I knew your sister, Brazen. In the name of God, what happened to you?
play Rambo after the door of the stamp book.
Rambo?
Yeah.
What? Yeah. Mustn't look too bad after all, huh? That's him? What's all? Kazan. Here comes your Rambo.
Fellas like him gives violence a bad name.
Thanks very much, sir.
Come on, we'll get that name.
Now, there we are. You sit down, Anna. And make yourself nice and comfy.
Thanks, sir.
And it won't take too long.
Thanks, sir.
Now, Mr. Harrigan, I'll do you next.
Oh, glad.
My word, would you have the body of Liz Hurley?
Say I the body of Liz Hurley. I must be divine.
Oh, what a wag you are. My goodness, bird, you must fly. What did you have? What did you
have? Which means sorry for him.
Mr. Hartover, whatever. He make my job look like Charles Bronson.
Did you ever think you'd get one of them jacuzzis?
It's a cat me wear. I can't even ride a bicycle.
Is a man in here for a combined was a shampoo and laxative? That's enough.
I'm out of car.
Wash and go. I'm sure I smell something burning. I'm sure I smell something burning.
And so do I. And you'll just walk by me, I'm sure.
Maggie, you heard Maggie's here, that liar.
What? Oh, help!
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome our guest artist, winner of this year's Over 60s competition, Joe O'Donovan.
To dream the impossible dream, to fight the unbeatable foe, to bear with unbearable sorrow, to run where the brave dare not go, to right the unrightable wrong, to love pure and chaste from afar, to try when your arms are too weary, to reach the unreachable soul. This is my quest, to follow that soul, no matter how hopeless, no matter how far, to fight for the right without question or pause, to be willing to march into hell for a heavenly cause. And I know that my heart will lie peaceful and calm when I'm laid to my rest, and the world will be better for this. That one man, scorned and covered with scars, still strove with his last ounce of courage to reach the unreachable star. I would try to say, all I want you to know. If I loved you, words would come in an easy way. Round in circles I'd go, longing to tell you, but afraid and shy, I let my golden chances pass me by. Soon you'd leave me, off you would go in a mist of day, never, never to know. Hold your head up high and don't be afraid of the dark. At the end of the storm is a golden sky and the sweet silver song of a lark. Walk on through the wind, walk on through the rain, though your dreams be tossed and blown. Walk on, walk on, with hope in your heart, and you'll never walk alone.
Peg, you're a smoke, you're a wine. now. Anyway, you should give him up. Don't you know that smoking sharpens your life?
That's sure. And I haven't tried a Jimmy chauffeur.
Ain't you all about Uncle Peter? He thinks he knows everything. And he doesn't know.
Jimmy, what's after all right then? Batman?
Up there?
Oh, we were on the job.
In the back row of the cinema.
Can't you admit to the court that yourself and Harry, that he will have the hit?
It was only a bit of a slap and tittle.
Is that so? And to the wonder who the rest dirty Harry for Cairn will manage? He said to this poor man here, Your Honor, is it like the man with the two wooden legs whose house was burned up? Give me a leg to stand up.
All right, then, Dodd, you can step down. Now, let's hear the complainant story. Oh, Government Grumbleton.
Call Government Grumbleton.
Call Government Grumbleton.
I hear you.
Hold the cards in your other hand.
I think we can dispense with all this if you don't mind. You!
Yes, sir.
Your face looks very familiar. How many times were you up before me?
I'm not sure you're ever in my training, eh, look?
Never mind, my good man. What have you to say in your defense? How did the pill get into this case?
Excuse me now, your highness, but tis time for a spin. Mr. Gaffer, he have the complaint. Now Uncle Peter.
Water.
Oh, Uncle Peter.
That's the judge's water.
Each day I live, I want to be Thank you. you know. Before I came out here, and I was looking at Equal, and I was reading down the desk corner, and one thing struck me forcibly was how the Owen managed to die in alphabetical order. We're talking about that. The first job I ever got was in an apprentice bus driver for that O'Connor's theatre above the Dockyard Bridge. And my job was now like out as a funeral to hold on to the horses. You still run away, you like? But the senior driver was a fella by the name of Nicholas. Anyway, I remember a good man and we were out in the car of the barn. And a very sad funeral. She was a young, very young widow. Nicholas. We saw her coming out of the graveyard, and he was a widower himself, like. So he says to me, Peter, hold on to the horse's head now. I'll go down and console the widow. Now, there's Joe, she was a fine woman. She was a bit of a lasher, like. So he goes down to her. And he says, I know as you're going through this very, and you've got to be prepared for that emotion. You're going to be very lonely. I thought, I know what I'm talking about. I got through it all. But to see, wouldn't it be nice to see if you and I know got together? Well, she said, that very nice of you. Well, she said, I'm promised to the man who shaved him. Was he a mind? He was all right, very, very, very poor. So I decided to stay for the family. Sent from Jimmy over to Leamington Spey. She was from Dagenham. Father from Birmingham. And the girl lived out in Blackpool. So he was saying to me, he said, Shamers, I want you now. This is what I want when the time comes. I want you to bring you over to Vans. And leave me overnight. The following night, bring me up to the North Chapel. The following day, after Harvest to Mass, bring me out to the Cork Park. Down Shandon Street, up Blarney Street. And halfway up Blarney Street, stop outside Bessie Carfield's home. Bring your mother and your auntie Elsie and Aunt Lizzie in. Give them the port and two biscuits. Give the children love and eat. Take a couple of pints and half ones for yourselves. And then, sissy, leave me outside like he always did. Was here, my dear, he was going to be a doula, first. And he was above in the room, and all of a sudden, did he smell crew beans behind him? So he called the doctor, says, yeah, attractor. I want just a second, yes, Dad, says he. Says he, would you ever tell your mother I'd like one bite off of a crow bean? Before I go.
as I came downstairs and came up against you, she died there. Yes, love. And Mama says no, dear, for after the funeral.
For many tricks. But we had one for the bow, dear. He was the best bow player in the equipment.
He was calling Mickey the Burbs.
Anyway, Mickey passed away, and all the bosses got together in the Bed Feckle Pub. They haven't yet to see what way they could remember. I'll give a monument to my king. So one fellow suggested that they get kind of a bunch of flowers on a shape in the shape of Shandon. And they said, that'd be no use, sir. Come the winter and all the flowers would blow here. And there'd be nothing left. She said, I suggest that we put 2 20-year old bows down on top of the coffin. And it'd be forever and ever and ever. About 10 years after they were out in the Corrigan Man Mansion, his wife passed away, and they were shoveling away the earth from the grave, and Maggie's two buddies, Bear and Reese, and Reese now had a good place by this, but he had to get around us. And then kind of lipstick around her lips the size of a truckin' bitch. And they were shoving the earth to in and all of a sudden did the two balls appear on the shoulder. And Barbara says, Reese, look what's on the shoulder. And Reese says, oh God. When did my address mean no more? I long before the event of the funeral walk. I remember we used to have to go out at night, you know, and this time I was working for Val's Uncle Jack. Oh, he was only home from America and he was very good. Sorry, America, you know, used to go to church. So about 2 o'clock in the morning, one morning, we were called up to this office and to look after things. And I went in and there was the cops lined up from the down the bay. So I couldn't get down one of his knees to stick it up stiffly. And I was just pushing her. And I says, Mr. O'Connor, what will I do with that? Can I give it a bit of a boot or something? So I couldn't find the boot. So I found it was a board in the corner. And I gave it a bit. And a man jumped up at the bed. Screaming and roaring, sweetie struck, and a woman we don't know runs to see we're in the wrong fucking house. You know what I think, about this, I mean, better look after myself.
times of trouble, Mother Mary comes to me, speaking words of wisdom, let it be.
Let it be.
tongue to bite, speak right, before I pass out me sinful to toast.
I'm telling you, why you getting too fond of your drink?
Well, it's like this, you see, Jim. After I kicks the bucket, I'm going to give me body to science. So in the meantime, it is me duty to keep it well preserved in alcohol.
Well, I am another one to drink, boy. The bags will be the death of you. And what's more, the smoke covers all nearly sophisticated.
Yes, so. But you look who's talking, Dickie. Look at the cousin. He's like a fellow with one foot in the grave.
And oh, boy. You mean one foot in the grave, don't you?
One foot in the grave. Didn't you see her? You wanted to be cremated out in ovens?
Extraordinary. How they called it these ovens years before there was any talk about cremation? How do they know?
Cremation, Jim. Of course, the question is, do your religion allow it?
Of course it do. Doesn't the Bible say all men are cremated equally?
Well, there's no answer to that. Oh, that's a lovely question. Isn't that a beautiful fight? Tis so lovely, tis nearly a sin to drink it. You know something, Chair? You can't beat a virgin pint.
Why am I a virgin pint?
Well, for example, now, like, didn't you ever hear of the virgin forest?
No, how is it?
A virgin forest, Jack, is where the hand of man have never set foot.
Why are you knows everything?
That's because I'm a fertile brain, Jack.
I know you have, and you never stop fertilizing.
Here, lads.
What?
I heard a very good one today.
What's it?
What is it?
How would you keep two agents in suspense?
How would you keep two
agents? I don't know.
I don't know, Dick. How would you?
Yes.
I'll tell you tomorrow.
That's very good, Dick. I like that. That's very good, Chad. He'll tell us tomorrow.
I don't see that wrong.
He's keeping us in suspense.
I don't see that wrong.
Jeff. Did you tell me one time that your father was an electrician?
That's right, he was.
He must have been his first shock.
Well, that was always a bit of a live wire. Listen, talking to live wires and things current.
Yeah.
What do you think, Nohmeyer, of the current state of the country?
Well, I can tell you this, Jack. You'd have me feeling very pessimistic. Very pessimistic, Dickie. You remind me of that story in the Bible where Moses said to the chosen people, lift up thy shovel, mount thy ass, and I will lead thee to the promised land. 2,000 years later, Jack Lynch said, lay down your shovel, rest your ass, this is the promised land. John Bruton taxes our shovel, kicks our ass, and says there's no promised land.
John Bruton is right. That's the only time that Ireland is a land of promise is coming up to election time.
And even then, you can't believe him. You can't believe him, Dickie. I've come to the conclusion that the only time politicians tell the truth is when they're calling each other liars.
And John Bruton.
Oh,
as he's doing the work of two men.
What two men?
Lal and Hardy.
Oh. But to be fair, Jack, you've got to ask yourself, could his opposite number, that's what you have, could he do any better? I seen Bertie being interviewed on the telly the other night. And the man says to me, says, Mr. Hurst, you see, some people say that as a politician, you're very indecisive.
So what's we see?
He says, maybe I am, maybe I'm not. What about Dick Sprague? What about Dick Sprague? I've come to the conclusion that that man thinks he's God himself. Well, he was over in Rome, dear recent, yes. And he asked how much would it cost to get buried in the Vatican. Yes. And he was told 25,000 pounds. 25,000 pounds, is he? That's too dear altogether. So I'll only be in the tomb for 3 days. What about you, Courtney, though?
No.
You, Courtney, did he?
Yes, sir.
The best man in the door.
Yes, sir.
I wouldn't be when he's a copper man. But dear, this is you, Courtney, Minister for Marine. And he was sunk by a leak.
I wouldn't mind, but it was a gas leak. How is it that we sit here now? The examiner said that the coalition government was doing its best to buck up the country.
Well, now, Jan, I'll be honest with you. During the Cork examiner, buck up would have been a misprint. See, Jan, some of the politicians, they don't have the brains. What some of them know about running the country could be written with a felt pen on a fly's ass. I have a story that illuminates that point. There was a buddy of mine travelling to Dublin on the train near recent.
Yeah.
And a fella got in and sat down opposite him. And the moment he sat down, he started scratching his elbow like that.
Yeah.
And kept on scratching it. And my buddy was observing him like. So he nudges the fella next to him. See, come here. See, do you see your man over there? Since he got onto the train, he's been scratching his elbow non-stop. And the other fella said, ah, yes, you see, but you'll have to excuse him. I know that poor man, and he's suffering from piles. Piles, simply, buddy. But he's scratching his elbow. Ah, yes, you see, but he's a politician. He don't know his ass from his elbow. Look at the health services in this country.
The health services, why, would make you sick.
True, fine. I mean, dear, dear, and they're cutting back on hospital facilities at a time that medical science is making great advances, boy. Great advances, Dickie. I was reading, dear, recent, about a fellow what was working in a factory.
Yeah?
And he'd get his hand caught in the machine, and the machine cut the hand clean off him. And to be able to throw the hand into a plastic bag, bring him down to hospital, and the doctors were able to sew on that hand again, boy. And he was back at work a month later, perfect, perfect! This time, didn't his arm get caught in the machine. And the machine cut the arm clean off. To be able to throw the arm into a plastic bag, bring him down to the hospital, and the doctors were able to sew on that arm again, boy. And he was back at work a month later, perfect, perfect! Well, he was looking into the machine. To see how his arm got caught in it, right? And in his head get caught. And the machine cut the head clean off him. So they threw the head into a plastic bag and they brought him down to the hospital.
And he was perfect.
No, he died.
What did that happen?
He suffocated in the plastic bag. Over to the first bed was an English fellow who was in the bed. the Pope says and what happened to you, my son. And the English fella says I was riding me motorbike and I was in an accident. And me arms were broken in several places. I'll never be able to use them again, the Pope says. Have faith, my son. Have faith. And he just touched your man's arms, said a little prayer, and in 2 seconds that fellow was me and his arms all over the place. It's a mess. So the Pope moved on to the second bed, and it was a Scots fellow was in that bed. And the Pope says, what happened to you, my son? And the Scots fellow said, I was working in a building site, you see. And a girder fell across me legs and crushed him. I'll never be able to walk again. Have faith, my son, said the Pope. Have faith. And he just touched your man's leg, said a little prayer, and in 2 seconds, he was doing a Scottish dance all over the bed. So the Pope moved over to the third bed. It was an Irish fellow, was in that bed. And when he sees the Pope coming, he pulls the sheet up over his head. And he says, Holy Father, like a good man, stay away from me now, because I could be claiming for cupboard.
Another fellow who's looking for big compensation.
Who's that?
Marlon Brando. After the Divine Rope Jump.
What about John Hurt?
John Hurt.
He must have been very sore. Oh, yes. I like Brando.
I like Brando.
I think he's a fine actor, Jamie. Yeah. A fine actor. Do you remember at all in that great film here some years ago? The Godfather. Remember that, Dickie?
Oh, brilliant.
He was the head of all the mafia.
What? And now he wants to become an Irish citizen?
What happened there? Can't they bring him up to the door? Introduce him to all the Irish mafia?
With your man Brando sitting in the front row of the door in his underpants.
I mean, the first time I fell in the door, I was caught with his pants. Well, in all fairness, that film business must have been a terrible disappointment by the Ballycock. In fact, to all of East Cork, Dickie, all of East Cork, yeah.
Except for Cove, boy. Oh, yeah. Except for Cove. As Cove can boast about Sanya or Sullivan. Yeah.
What a run of that girl is, Dickie.
Boy, that girl can run faster than a streaker through a field of nettles. Oh.
Sanya Sullivan. The Cove Express, huh? Oh. What a lovely to see her here in Berlin, and she carrying the green, white, and gold.
Especially the gold. I hope not as heavy as the old flagpole in Gothenburg. In fairness, isn't she a great example to the young people?
Oh, and badly needed, boy. Badly needed. I mean, there's so many young people today. They're caught up in sex, drugs, crime of all sorts. But I heard recently that there was an American in a part of this city, what shall be nameless now in fairness like, and he was tracing his relatives, and he wanted them big, powerful cars like, and he calls over the uncle and he says, hey, come over here, he says, if I park me car there, says he, will it be there when I come back? You know what the young fella says? He says, mister, no matter what part of the city you park that car in, tis up here for me when you get back. all fairness, you can't blame the young people all together. I always say it, yeah, tis their pop stars have the children driven mad, but ones like Madonna, Prince, Michael Jackson, Sinead O'Connor,
Daniel O'Donnell.
You know, some young people today, they don't even have manners like, they don't even have manners. I was always taught when I was young to be polite. Polite don't cost nothing, Dickie. I always remember the very first dance I went to. And I went up to this girl, I says she was no more than 2 or 3 years older than myself, mate. And I says, excuse me, miss, says I, but can I have the next dance? You know what she said? She looks down her nose at me like that, and she says, I have no intention of dancing with a child.
How much is it?
I was polite. I was polite. I said, that's quite all right, miss. I didn't realize you were in that condition. What you lack in intelligence, you make up in stupidity. Anyway, as I was saying, I think the parents must take some of the blame for the children today. I remember when I was young, if I gave any sauce at home, it had a terrible, strange effect on me father.
How strange, no, right?
First of all, he forgets who he was. Because he'd catch me by the scruff of the neck, and he'd poke me with his finger, and he'd say, do you know who I am? And then he'd forget who I was. Because he'd say, who do you think you are? And then he'd think he was a ventriloquist. Because he'd go, you're up to beg me before I break your fist.
The kids are very miniature.
Excuse me, sir, do you know, Jack? They want to be miniature, like.
Miniature back has turned me up to something.
Oh, I see what you mean, Jack, and all right, you are. Only yesterday, the mother-in-law arrived home, and I said... Jack...
And a very good eye. I'll tell you tomorrow.
For a second, Chair, if brains were chocolate, you wouldn't have enough to fill a smarty. Anyway, I was telling you about the mother-in-law arriving home yesterday.
Yes, don't.
All right. And the youngest goes up to her, and he says, Granny, Granny, do your trick. And she says, what trick, love? He says, me dad says you can drink like a fish.
You'll be taken after yourself,
boy. You know, sometimes, Jack, I often see it to myself that children never grow up, but...
The thing is, boy, how do you know when your children are grown up?
You know when your children are grown up, Jack. When they stop asking you where they came from and refuse to tell you where they're going. Calm down, Tom. And of that, there's no doubt. Unemployment was never so high. Sure, it is half your cruel to buy one pint of stout. It would make a man go on the dry. But it won't get us down, cause a smile makes a frown. Now with that we feel sure you'll agree. So keep up your smile, and goodbye for a while. From the banks of me, oh, hello.
Glorious way, land of my endeavor, land of in the gloaming, in the bunny bags of fly, roaming in the gloaming, with a lassie by my side. When the sun has gone to rest, that's the time that I love best. Oh, it's lovely roaming in the gloaming, for I love a lassie, a bonny, bonny lassie. She's as sweet as the heather in the dell. She's as sweet as the heather, the bonny blooming heather, Mary, my Scots bluebell. Fifth rim, I hear my warmth and love, but still my thoughts return to my ain folk over yonder in the shillin by the burn. I see the coursey inkle and the mist above the brae, and joy and sadness mingle as I list the old world lay. But it's home that I'm longing for my aim, and they be but lowly, poor and plain folk. I am far beyond the sea, but my heart will ever be at him in dear old Scotland with my name. Since I there telling the old folk by the fire, and I mark the swift year whirling as the ruddy flame leaps high. Ah, my mother would caress me were I but by her side. Now she prays the heaven would bless me, the stormy seas divide. But it's home that I'm longing for my ain folk, and they be but lowly, poor and plain folk. I am far beyond the sea, but my heart will at him in dear old Scotland with my ain folk. Every road through life is a long, long road, full of joys and sorrows too. As you journey on, how your heart will yearn for things most dear to you. With health and wealth to sow, as onward we must go. Keep right on to the end of the road, keep right on to the end. Though the way be long, let your heart be strong, keep right on from the bend. When you're tired and weary, still journey on, till you come to your happy abode. And all your love you've been dreaming of will be there at the end of the king. Right on from then, for you're done.
dear, that's nice and sandy. Hurry, Tonto, for someone takes it. Come on, give it to Bob.
We never take it easy. Get this fanny done, mother. And rush. Come to the whole day in front of us. I think the beach is going to disappear or something. Not about disappearing. Here's your mother disappear, sir.
She's over there behind the wall. She's changing.
I should have known. Even Paul Daniels couldn't make her disappear. Why is she changing it anyway? Reckon it?
She's changing into her new beach look.
So what's taking her so long? Are you sure that's not how she's doing behind the wall? For God's sake, get her out here before she brings the girls down on top of us.
Mother! Louie! We're over here, Mother! I never knew Bottom was fond of the birds.
Fond of the birds? St. Francis was only trapped.
upstairs.
About tonight?
Listen, girl, I was a member. It don't matter where a man gets his appetite, as long as he has his dinner at home. Someday, like the good girl you are now, get up the bottle of sun tonight.
Bottle, how are you? She's a chug new man. And don't forget to put some on your tongue. Maybe after you're done, forget some bun.
But when you're going to try being there now, I tell you where to put some sun lotion. Whoopi dick.
Because the June hunt we saw in May, I'm in the shade of the
get him here, you what?
That's it. Now, Jerry, I'm warning you.
Not getting caught.
your socks. I didn't forget that fast. I have them on purpose. The water is too cool.
Would you take one look at him? Hot one man submarine. So I'll just come someday. He's your king. Tell me with me the snooker table, then char his head. Peggy, what? Keep your hand in your fine, yeah. This rat might pull you under.
You never ever get off the beach, and see the toys are afraid to come in.
Don't pat down past your dip, and keep your legs bent on it, as you might draw. I mean, you conduct the strippers.
There's no danger you drowning anyway. You're a building spare tire.
Here, put out your marker. Put out your marker. I'll show you who can swim.
If you can swim, I'm a monkey's uncle.
They say that you're a relation, don't you, miss?
Come here. You can't just play yourself in that thing. Everybody be looking at you.
Listen. I'm proud.
You can't open that thing!
Why not get open that thing? No! I'm gonna open this thing!
Thank you.
kindnesses?
Yes!
There's a little old cold I twitched in. You see, he'd have to forgive me now if I was as mad as half tonight. For I've reasons for it. You see, to this time 20 years ago, that my late husband, passed away. God rest his poor soul now, wherever he is. But in other words, I'm celebrating this 20th anniversary. And here, I remember it as if it was yesterday. It was a Saturday night that he melted away towards the world in the middle of a heat wave. Of course, Mrs. Carpus, no, don't laugh at him like that, Tano. Carpus, we all know he was ailing for a while. He got a blockage. Doing money. Now, speaking ailing did not, but he was a mare to drink. And if you kissed him, you wouldn't have to worry about germs. He was mild most of the time. Will I ever forget the night I rubbed a drop of whiskey on his bed back? And he nearly broke his neck trying to lick it out. Prepare for my death. He was always making things awkward for others. And he never lasted even when he died. I'll explain out to you what I mean, you see. Every year we used to go to the yard for the Harvest Weekend. And we'd take the early train on the Sunday morning. And the minute we'd arrive in the yard, he'd go straight into Clancy's pub. And when he was trying to come home on Monday night, he'd have a better colour than if he spent the weekend on the Strand. Anyway, there we were now 20 years ago. Booked in Tiana now as usual for the Sunday and the Monday. With our deposits paid and all. And what does Harker do? Doesn't he die on this early night? Be awkward like. What can I do? I could go on me own. Come home early to get ready for the week. I heard Sally, I went to Tancast, I didn't enjoy me, said one bit. I'm sure boat close for the weekend. But as I am, this year, things could have been way worse. Wasn't it a good job for me that Harker, he didn't wait until we arrived in Yard before he decided to pass on? Could you imagine the job I'd have had lugging him home in the train again? And here, couldn't be the first time he came home stiff. But anyway, the first thing I did when I came home was over to the examiner office to put in the date notice. I was to inquire about the departure department, I says. And me, fancy, she, is it Erling that you're looking for? No, says I. Me husband had departed, and I was to advertise it in the paper. she, the dead column. The dead column, that cost you £1 an inch. £1 an inch, says I. Forget it, says I. That man was 6'4". Can I tell you, I don't laugh at this bit, no, man. This is the really common crowd, you know. Anyway, by the time I got home, the holy nuns had arrived to lay him out. Now, I haven't laid him out, we said we were Friday night. But God bless the holy nuns, they done a lovely chap in him. They even stuck in his fast teeth that he hadn't worn for years. He was so innocent looking at him first. He was like Bosco. Only he was a different kind of a box. And the wig, like I said about the wig, it went from strength to strength. and your relations, you came with your thousands. And I didn't know half of them. There was one for the kid. He was stoicious with the other one. He didn't like him. And we put him up in the corner or in the way by the piano. And whatever look I came after, there he was kneeling down and he praying into the piano. And when he seen me looking, he says, "That man, your husband had it up," he said, "it is." And there was poor Harker, and for once he was taking it all lying down. But here, I'd have been last when he's me two buddies, except the Bulger. Except the Bulger and Greta Dooley. Two merry witches like me said. And it's something she was married to a big heavy man. He worked in Dunlap's and Gorka headquarters. And this here man used to keep me ferret. Thank God there was one night when this ferret died. Didn't the man himself die? My head was of a broken heart. It's something she took it very bad. Very bad. Because she was mad about the ferret. But as I said to her at the time, that man died in his sleep. That man didn't know he was dead in time. And Greta then was married to another fella. He was a small wisp of a fella. And he was a jockey. And he went over to England racing. And God was, he never won a race in his life. Larry the Last, he was calling him. The guy was going there, but I know guy was wasn't he killed from the kick of a horse? And Greta had to go over to England to identify the body. And they brought him to kind of a hospital. It was freezer, where they keep all the bodies in drawers, like. And they couldn't find Larry nowhere. Because when you opened the first drawer, it wasn't Larry at all. And the second drawer wasn't Larry either. And the same with the third. But when they opened the fourth drawer, dear was Larry. That's him, says Greta. That's him, all right, you see. The same in death as in life. Never in the first three. Well, that was I enjoyed old Chatty and your great old Cole, and it'll be a lovely song this year for you, and it's called Just the Song of Twilight, and there's such a lovely crowd, I know you'll let me in the chorus. Lovely words to you. Thanks, friends.
Once in the dear days beyond recall, when on the world the mist began to fall, out of the dreams that rose in happy throng, close to our hearts, love sang an old sweet song. And in the dusk, where fell the firelight gleam, softly it wove itself into our dream. Just a song at twilight, when the lights are low and the flickering shadows softly comes and goes. Oh, the heart be weary, sad the day and long, still to us at twilight.
love song of yore. Deep in our hearts, it dwells forevermore. Footsteps may falter, weary grow the way. Still, we can hear it at the close of day. And then the end, when life's dim shadows fall, 'tis love will be found, the sweetest song of all. The last time in God love you, just the song at twilight, when the lights are low and the flickering shadows softly come and go. Over heart, be weary, sad the day and long. Still to us at twilight comes love's old song, comes love's old sweet song.
Any night. To all of you, thanks again. Stay home. God bless you.